Today, we're going to dive into 10 curious facts on dengue, from mosquitoes to warning symptoms to diagnosis and treatment. Very importantly, we ask, do we really need platelet transfusion? Is there a vaccine for dengue fever? This is part one of a two-part lecture series. First curious fact. You see in your picture four different types of mosquitoes. Which one of them causes dengue? Pause the video, think about it, restart, and we're going to discuss why. Have you made your choice? Well, this is the answer. These two mosquitoes with their white bands on their feet are the ones that transmit dengue fever, and we call this Aedes mosquito. But why these two pictures? I'll show you. But before that, I'm going to talk to you about Culex species of mosquito. You see this mosquito here, it's a Culex mosquito. It transmits quite a few diseases, from Rift Valley fever, Japanese encephalitis, West Nile virus, and filariasis. I'm not going to talk about these diseases here. You can look it up on your own. But very importantly, the Culex mosquito is a night biter. And this is in contrast to the Aedes mosquito, which is a day biter. It likes to bite indoors and around the house. You have here the Anopheles mosquito. It transmits a malaria parasite. It is a night biter. And it doesn't like strong wind because it's not a strong flight mosquito. So if you are on the beach, the chances of you getting bitten by Anopheles against a strong sea breeze is going to be rather slim. Again, night biter in contrast with the Aedes mosquito. And how do you recognize Anopheles? Well, look at this picture. As the mosquito bites into the human skin, it kind of levels itself at about 30 degrees to the surface instead of the others, which are parallel to the surface. At about 30 degrees, it bites in, and that's an Anopheles mosquito. These two pictures show two kinds of Aedes mosquito. One's the Aedes aegypti and one's Aedes albopictus. They transmit dengue fever, Zika, as well as chikungunya. They are both day biters, biting from dawn till dusk. In addition, the Aedes aegypti tends to follow the lives of human beings at around a house or the equipment that's thrown around collecting rainwater. Remember, they like clean water, stagnant, about the size of a 20 cents coin in the context of Singapore, which is about the size of a £1 coin, a sterling pound coin. In the case of Aedes albopictus, it tends to find it in the jungles. It looks at any crevices on the plants or the trees where it can collect water. Again, a small amount of clear, stagnant water is all that they need to transmit infections. Now, the Aedes aegypti is rather unique. Compared to the Anopheles, it is a much stronger mosquito. So the NEA Authority of Singapore actually released Aedes aegypti that have been sterilized at the bottom of a block of disused flats. Now, these disused flats do not have lift access, there's no electricity running through, and what they did was they set traps all along the floors. And despite at a height of more than 20 floors, they could still catch back the mosquitoes which they released, telling you that these mosquitoes can fly all the way to more than 20 floors. So you might be living on the 20th floor, but the mosquito can still hunt you down. How it does it? It kind of flies along the edge of the walls. That way, it doesn't have to battle too strongly against the winds. And with it, slowly, it goes up one floor, another floor, and a third floor, hunting for its next meal. Second curious fact. I was never diagnosed with dengue fever, and I'm dengue fever naive. Is that true or false? Think about the question, pause, and come back and join us. Now, the answer is obviously false, because there are many, many people who have dengue fever and they thought it was the first time. In truth, it was the second time, because many people may have asymptomatic dengue. In fact, 70% of the people have asymptomatic dengue. In other words, I perhaps could be bitten by a mosquito and the virus would be swimming inside me, growing inside me, but it doesn't cause me to have any fever, headache, or muscle ache. I have dengue, but without the symptoms. Asymptomatic dengue happens when you get infected with the virus, but yet you have no symptoms to it. You will in turn develop immunity to the virus that's swimming inside your body, which you've been infected with. It could be dengue 1, 2, 3, and 4. And after being infected with one, you can be infected with the second one, the third, and subsequently the fourth dengue infection. After the first dengue infection, the second dengue is actually worse. And the reason is because of antibody-dependent enhancement. The first antibody doesn't quite neutralize the second virus which you get infected with. Instead of trying to neutralize it, it worsens it and makes the infection more severe. So the second dengue is actually worse. I won't go into the details, but a recent study suggests the amount of antibodies which you have will in turn determine the severity of your second dengue infection. Third curious fact. What are the warning signs of dengue? I have here in front of you five different symptoms. Think about it, which of these are warning signs? Pause and get back to us. Welcome back. Of these five symptoms, fever, rash, abdominal pain with vomiting, platelets and bleeding, the two most important signs are actually vomiting and abdominal pain as well as bleeding. These are the warning signs of dengue. If you have them, you are headed for trouble. This is a busy slide describing WHO classification of dengue in 2009. The criticism of the old classification was it doesn't preempt the individual or the doctor in anticipating problems with dengue fever. And this slide, though very busy, holds a lot of good information which the man in the street, that's yourself, can actually appreciate and look after yourself and think about if you have dengue fever. So very quickly, you see a box on your left, which I highlighted in yellow. These are the symptoms which you present with when you're dengue fever. That's dangerous, but the real danger comes in with severe dengue, which is a bad outcome. At that stage, you actually have severe plasma leakage, you have severe hemorrhage, which is bleeding, and you have severe organ impairment. So what happens in this group is severe dengue, there's a 2 to 5% chance of dying despite treatment. If you're not treated, there's a 20% chance of dying. So death is real, you may actually lose your life. What I really want you to focus on is actually the warning signs which I'm highlighting here in the red box. The warning signs are what you ought to know so as to prepare yourself if you are going to end up with severe dengue. These are the warning signs which I've expanded in a much easier view. You see several symptoms and I'm going to take you through each one of them. First is actually abdominal pain or tenderness, which is usually in the upper abdomen, just below your rib cage. You can end up with persistent vomiting. In persistent vomiting, wherever it's in your stomach, you can vomit out, and in turn, you can't retain fluids. You need water to overcome dengue. In some cases, you have clinical fluid accumulation. The cell-to-cell barrier, it opens up and plasma will leak out, in turn causing accumulation in the skin, accumulation in the tummy, accumulation in the chest, between the lungs as well as the ribcage. This accumulation of fluids can be a problem and it actually lowers down the blood pressure. In some situations, a person may have mucosal bleeding, or they feel very, very lethargic and restlessness. Many people feel tired after dengue infection, but in these cases, they are really dead out tired. They don't want to get out of bed at all. I will monitor myself with all the red bars which are highlighted, but I will also ask my doctors for the blue bars which I'm highlighting here. In particular, whether it's my liver swollen or whether there's a rise in hematocrit. What's hematocrit? Hematocrit is a little figure that's found in your blood count laboratory test. is the ratio of the volume of red blood cells to the volume of the plasma volume. When you compare these two values, you can in turn determine how concentrated your blood is. The more concentrated, the worse the outcome. So I would aim for falling hematocrit to suggest that I am improving with my dengue treatment. You may be familiar with dengue fever and its other names. Example, dengue fever, classical dengue fever, dengue hemorrhagic fever, and dengue shock syndrome. These has a role to play in actually collecting data on the number of bad cases of dengue you have. But it has its limitations. It does not guide the clinician or the individual on the risk of progressing into severe disease. So in terms of prognostication, in terms of guidance, I prefer the new WHO classification in 2009, but statistically, when you collect data on the number of dengue cases you have, this method, the old method, still works. Fourth curious fact. Each dengue fever gets successively worse. So you have dengue 1, the second dengue, the third dengue, and the fourth dengue. Does each one get worse? And does it mean the fourth dengue is the worst? Pause there, think about it, and get back to us on the next after that. The answer is wrong. In fact, the first dengue is bad and the second dengue is the worst. Thereafter, if all things being equal, it gets better and better. To appreciate the first, second, third, fourth dengue fever, we should look at this cartoon from the PLOS medicine. The first dengue infection tends to be bad. It is yellow, which is considered as moderate severity. But the second, because of ADE, antibody-dependent enhancement, it gets worse. The disease risk becomes doubly bad. But the third one, because of more adequate and more amount of antibodies, and at the same time, some of the antibodies may actually help to cross-neutralize, you end up with a better scenario. So your third dengue is actually good. And your fourth dengue, because you have met three before with high amount of antibody levels, in turn you end up with a doubly good situation. So it looks as if each successive dengue, you get better and better, except for the second one. Second onwards, it gets better. But should I bet my life on it? Well, this is very much in theory. When I do get my third and fourth dengue infection, I might be 70 or 80 years old, and my health would not be what it was when it was 20 or 30 years old when I had my earlier dengue infections. So I will not risk it. In other words, I still have to be very careful with my third or fourth dengue infection, though in theory, it is actually better. Fifth curious fact. What are the most important tests in dengue fever? Is it platelets, hematocrit, white blood cell, or a kidney liver function? I'm going to ask you to think about it, pause the video, and come back to us. Well, the most important test is actually hematocrit. Hematocrit is the most important test. For those of you who chose platelets, it's the second most important test because the hematocrit predicts the severity of illness and in turn something which we can do. Remember the warning signs table? Down here, right at the bottom, you find the hematocrit section. An increase in hematocrit concurrent with a rapid decrease in platelet count is very important. It predicts severity illness. Hematocrit rising means the blood is becoming more and more concentrated and you ought to do something with more fluids, drink more water either, or infusion of fluid so as to dilute out the hematocrit. That is crucial in preventing progression to severe disease. That comes to the end of the presentation. I hope you enjoyed it. At Rophi Clinic, we really want to make science simple and relevant for everyone. Do subscribe to our channel so you can be updated when there's a new video out. And if you have a follow-up question, be it on dengue, COVID, or anything related to infectious diseases, drop us a comment at the bottom of the screen. We will attend to it and this will give us ideas on what the next video should be. So until then, see you. Bye.